So yeah, so hi. My name is Robert Musaki. I'm an engineer at Joyent, and I spend most of my time there working on Lumos. Some things I've done there are just the per thread caching in the VueMem. I've done some KVM work, done some networking work, kind of go all over the place, kind of wherever the most recent panic or core dump takes me. So with that, let's get started. So, software-defined buzzword. Okay, so obviously we're using software-defined networking here. We're playing buzzword bingo a little bit, but let's actually define what our buzzwords mean this time around. So kind of what we're trying to get at the core of this is that whenever you're dealing with software-defined network storage, the new software-defined data center, you know, whatever you want to call it, basically you're trying to minimize the amount of work you have to do or how you do that work. So you're trying to basically deal with setting up your core infrastructure once. You don't want to have to go through, I mean, I'm sure most of us who have had to administer systems have gone through, plugged in to our serial cables on our switches, gone through, added a VLAN on every switch, moved on with life, gone through, had to update a BIOS setting when you go through, great, reboot, miss your 5 second window, repeat. And so the goal of this stuff is to basically take that aspect, kind of the more manual aspect of it, out of the equation, and where necessary, create new software abstractions in both the operating system and above. So let's kind of get to the kind of the core of the problem that we're trying to solve here. So at the heart of it is always network isolation. So if you think of, we have memory isolation on systems. Those of you who might be ran on the 8386 or ran Windows 3.1 might remember fun times where one processor would scribble over some part of memory it shouldn't have, and you get a beautiful blue screen of death. Thankfully, these days, all of our operating systems use virtual memory, so that's not actually a problem that we have with respect to memory. So we want the same kind of principles on the network. There's a lot of things that if you put two untrusted people on a network, they can do to screw each other over. I can start trying to poison your ARP cache, I can spoof your MAC address, I can just see your traffic if I'm unlucky. And for depending on what you're doing and what the environment is, that's actually not acceptable at all. So the core of what we're looking for here is actually network isolation to the extent that's possible. Obviously, at the end of the day, you do need to connect to the broader internet, but usually people are doing that through gateways or through load balancers or public-facing entities. You don't want to necessarily have that going through your entire network stack. That then also leads us to the problem of address space control. So we all know the great 10/8, you know, 192.168/16, the 172 address space. The problem is that when you start using other providers, you start mixing that up, you're saying, great, hey, I use 10.169/16 at home. Hey, why are you giving me an IP address segment in 10.169/16? Like, why are you doing that? And so because of our desire for network isolation and how this is put out, we also need to have address space control. So we actually need to be able to control as users, this is what are the set of IP addresses that we're using to make our own lives easier because of just the headaches of how networking works today. The first kind of pass at this was VLANs. So by a VLAN, you basically are going, has anyone here not heard of VLANs? Okay, great. So with VLANs, we're basically modifying the ether type, adding a 12-bit ID that basically indicates what's a VLAN ID. So the idea is basically you're multiplexing about 4,000 different LAN segments on one. That's great, but as we just said, there's 4,000. So that means also now you've hit one pretty big scaling limit. If I said, hey, I can only have 4,000 customers, you know, our sales guys would be pretty sick. And on top of that, VLANs, while useful, can be often annoying to program. There's a lot, you might say, okay, great, I'm gonna just set an allowed list in the switch, or I may have to go put every specific switch port in access mode, or is it tag mode, or is it both? Is there a default VLAN, is there not? So there's a lot of ways that you can do this and get it wrong. And more importantly, if you actually need to change it, we have to go through our switches, update them, and you know, we actually end up having a chance for human error, or you know, we've all been in there where it's just like, hey, we did a rolling switch upgrade, but we have to also upgrade the firmware while we're at it, and then you kind of have a rolling cascading failure and series of downtime. The other thing that we really want to be able to solve is start creating new foundations for basic building blocks of network services. So today, sometimes we have different ways of deploying load balancers, firewalls, switches. These today are generally hardware, so we'll use software gateways, software load balancers. It's very manual setup, how it interacts with the address space, how to interact with your VLANs, generally often requires a lot of manual work to be done. So we want to kind of see what we can do to get out of that. And in general, we also want to avoid magic hardware while doing this. So let's talk about what the industry is doing in this space. So the industry is kind of trending towards consensus in two different encapsulation formats. So what these encapsulation formats do is let's take an entire layer two packet, so that's the Ethernet header, the IP header, whether it's TCP IP and the payload. We're going to stick that in something else and send it out on the network. So in this case, with something like NVGRE, what you do is to take my entire layer two payload, slap a little bit of a header on it that basically gives it a new wider ID space, so in this case a 24-bit ID space as opposed to 12-bit, and then I'm going to send that somewhere on my underlay network, so my real network. So I'm just going to go look up the IP address of the host that has the target, the virtual target, send it there. So the idea being that if I have VMA on host foo and VMB on host baz, then what I'm going to do is when I send a packet with A, I'm going to encapsulate it, send it on my real network to the other host, decapsulate it, and inject it into the guest net. The other one that's doing this is VXLAN. So VXLAN is similar, whereas NVGRE uses the GRE header, VXLAN just uses UDP. So basically it takes a standard packet, tags on an extra little 8-byte header, which includes 24 bits of identifier, and then sends that through a normal UDP packet to another host. And the reason I highlight these is because industry is actually kind of, there's other ones that are out there, but these are actually in hardware. So the most recent Broadcom switch ASICs all have support for it. The next generation of Intel NICs, which are now the 40 gig parts, they all have support for these. So you're seeing
the Intel
Altachips
do too.
The what?
The Intel
Altachips,
which is Intel's
core. Yeah, so there's a lot of support for this, just more generally these formats in parts. So we've kind of started to trend towards these. There are others that have come. You know, no two network vendors are part of two of the same two standards here. You know, they kind of pose new ones and go, but this is what's in hardware, and that kind of is what people end up using, because we want to use what our NICs and switches support. However, on the flip side, there's a lot of industry anarchy. So we talked about, there's great, we all said that we're going to use VXLAN. But actually, the way the VXLAN spec says to do is that you're going to have to use a multicaster per VXLAN identifier. Most network admins all of a sudden want to come up and strangle you by the thought of saying, great, please enable lots and lots of multicast traffic on my network. To make that even worse, take your standard kind of top of rack switch. So it has these nice 40 tables, it keeps track of MAC addresses. It keeps track of, say, 100,000 MAC addresses, only for unicast traffic. If, say, you now want to have multicast traffic, you do more than 1,000, 2,000, it's like, I give up, I'm just gonna broadcast this everywhere on the network. And you're like, well, great, I had 4,000 VLANs. Now I got 2,000 of these before I flood my network, and now you're sending every packet everywhere. Thanks a lot, pal. So to deal with that, there's a lot of different ways to actually go about and manage this. And basically, people want to create their own logical topology mappings. So you have the OpenFlow series of things, which used to be about how to do hardware switches, which is now about software switches, and it's left people to different degrees of happiness. VMware had Nicira, there's PlumGrid, there's a bunch of ways that are coming up and using this in user land, there's a bunch of folks who are doing this in hardware switches and the like. So basically, there's no general consensus, there's no agreement, so there's just a lot of anarchy. So that kind of tells us that whatever we do in Illumos, we need to actually be pretty flexible here and make sure that we basically make it easy to plug into whatever extant system we have, because there's going to be no one single system. If we just write assuming up and start with this one system, it's going to be wrong. So here we enter into what we call overlay devices. So the overlay device is a new DLADM construct. So DLADM is the command that we use to manage data links. So the same way that you would create a VNIC, you can now create an overlay device. These overlay devices generally are operating in the context of a level 3 of the NetStack. So they're kind of doing IP level traffic. So unlike a VNIC, which is created over a specific device, so you'd say like do DLADM create VNIC over my Intel NIC, here you're really just specifying it in the context of a given zone. It's kind of like an ether stub in that respect, but where an ether stub is basically just a unmanaged, just kind of switch that just exists in the one zone, It doesn't go anywhere. This actually then gets output to the actual network. Here, you then, once you have this, you can create VNICs on top of it and kind of do all the other management. Yeah, question?
Design-wise, is it closer to IPTon than it would be to an Etherstep?
It's similar to IPTon in the sense of tunneling. Yeah. It's similar to an Etherstub in the sense of how does it behave when you have multiple Mac devices on top of it.
Okay.
So
thank you.
It's kind of a hybrid there.
So I was hoping. Thank you.
So here there's basically two main different aspects of an overlay device. You have your encapsulation format. So that's basically how am I actually putting this on the wire, and that's all something that lives in the kernel. So that's, for example, is like VXLAN. So we basically know how to do VXLAN. We know how to do that in the kernel. You don't have to go to userland, ask userland, hey, how do I go create a VXLAN header? You know, it doesn't make sense, especially when that's in your network hot path. What we then have in userland instead is the question of, I have this MAC address. Where should it go? Like, where should I send it? That, we ask user, basically there's a userland way of answering that, and that then can get filled in and cached by the kernel. So you'll have to pay a little bit of cost for the very first one of these, and it gets cached and used everywhere. So not much more than your initial hard request to do it. So this is the high-level architecture that we're looking at. So this is kind of looking for the kind of, if you look at, consider this as the data path, what you have coming in here is, so say you have something that's doing TCP/IP or using, you know, the VND work I did with KVM or something else. That's going to come in, that's sitting on a VNIC, whether that's in a zone or not. That VNIC is then created on top of an overlay device. The overlay device in this case will then go off, it basically says, hey, do I know about this, about the destination of this? If so, it just encapsulates it, sends it out the networking stack that of where the device was created, so that'll just go down the wire. When we don't know about where to go, we basically have a userland daemon, which we call varkd, which is the virtual world daemon. So we call it that because that actually is really synonymous with what it's actually doing. The point of this is to basically go through, instead of taking where ARP takes a logical IP address and is asking what is the MAC address corresponding to it, we're saying is given a MAC address, which is a logical construct, what is the physical host on my network that should receive this packet? So that goes into userland. There's a bunch of different ways you can go do this. You know, I've implemented a few as prototypes, and there's a few more coming along. Importantly, we kind of to note that the way they communicate is an asynchronous upcall. The point of that is just to make sure that, just like ARP, where if something doesn't respond, while traffic for that one IP address is backed up, the entire system doesn't get backed up behind it, that we maintain that same kind of principle. If for some reason we can't find out where one packet is destined, we don't want to block every other packet on that at all. Otherwise, we're just going to waste, you're basically just asking userland to do bad stuff to you. If the userland daemon disappears because you have something goes wrong, you don't want everything to just back up, eat all your kernel memory, and then, you know, go to swap death. So the overlay driver that we talked about is a GLDB3 driver, so it's kind of a, fits into the standard networking driver that we do for other devices. It has a notion of encapsulation. So all of these encapsulation methods basically have some ID space. VXLAN, NVGRE is a 24-bit one. Some of the others, that like STT that VMware did briefly that hasn't picked up too much traction, had a larger 64-bit ID. So basically, the key point is that basically, just like you have a VLAN ID that you associate with something, you have an encapsulation ID or, you know, a virtual network ID that's associated with it. And the idea is that anything that's on one virtual network can talk to anything else on that virtual network, but obviously if you're on two different virtual networks, they can't see each other, can't talk to each other, anything like that. There's a core kernel driver, which has a lot of the, keeps track of a lot of this stuff. There's also an encapsulation module, so basically we've kind of logically split out how did the logic of, the kind of the core logic of dealing with, how do we deal with packets, how do we do lookups, how do we kind of go back and forth with just the mechanics of how do I encapsulate something with VXLAN? How do I write that header? Or given a header, how do I figure out which virtual network this corresponds to? So the goal there is just to make it easier for us to go and add new and additional encapsulation modules, because the reality is that while this generation of hardware has VXLAN and NVGRE, who knows what the next generation will have? And, you know, for as much consensus as the industry has, there's just as much anarchy. So you know, we want to have that flexibility in place.
So does that represent a new kernel module type?
It's just a missed module.
So you didn't create a new module?
No, I did not create a new module type. It's very similar to what we already have in Mac already for doing different Mac types, like Ethernet or InfiniBand or the like. So there's nothing too crazy there. The overlay device also keeps track of kind of the destination mode. So you could have a traditional point-to-point tunnel, like people have set up with VPNs. It's just like, hey, all traffic from host A, just always send it to host B. Like, don't care, just a point-to-point tunnel. And then the other mode is obviously a much more dynamic mode where we have to kind of pay attention, ask, retain, and cache this information about where do we go. Basically, that's where you can do a lot, you have a lot more flexibility because you can actually have multiple hosts in there, but it's a bit different. Yeah.
In your point-to-point mode, do you ever have to query your resolver agent?
Or no, you never have to talk to the user land on your point-to-point land.
It's basically just the design.
It's just sitting there the second you basically create it.
Yeah.
The other thing here is that, so I've already implemented VXLAN for this, so that's what we're using at Joint. It's a nice thing, it already works with other VXLAN implementations, so we actually can have a bit of confidence there. So you can take OpenBSD boxes that have VXLAN or other implementations, and you can actually create the standard point-to-point tunnels or multicast tunnels and talk to them. The other thing that's kind of worth pointing out is that each of the different encapsulation modules can have their own set of properties. So because VXLAN speaks UDP, it has a default port, has to have a UDP port associated with it. We have a default port that's been assigned, but there's also older ports. You know, people may want to use a different port in their own things, in their own data centers, so these modules are allowed to define their own properties, which all show up in DLADN, which makes it just easier for, as you add these things, to kind of manage it. That's not just, hey, we need to go update the core overlay device code just because we want to go add a new property to VXLAN. So we talked about kind of the user land side of this, so that's again kind of the core of the logic is all in varpd. It has a door server for libdl management d, so, and libdladm. So as you are typing, you know, dladm create overlay, you don't have to know about varpd, you don't have to know about the kernel. It basically creates a single place where you can basically set and manage all the properties. So dladm takes care of all the logic of how do I conjoin these two kind of suddenly disjoint sources of information. So the kind of important things that we make sure the kernel always is in charge of the information that the kernel needs, and userland is always in charge of the information that userland needs. So we don't kind of basically treat the kernel as an extended data store for random userland lookups. On the flip side, userland isn't an authoritative source for information that's in the kernel, which has caused us headaches in the past. This goes through and talks to the kernel over a simple bioptal interface. So the design of this, again, is that it can fail. We have to assume that, you know, no matter how well we write the software, a crash can occur. You know, something will go wrong. We need to make sure that the kernel is resilient about this and we can actually handle this correctly. Lookups, again, are implemented in these pluggable backends. So that basically gives us more flexibility. It makes it an easier, simpler interface for people who need to write their own custom lookups or need to interface with some other system. Because that's going to be a more common case for a while, as we figure out, you know, what it is that we're going to use kind of more collectively, this or our own environments have individual requirements in terms of how we do that lookup. That's where we're going. The other thing is that there's a core library here as part of this, like a libvarp, which takes care of being able to do useful things for packet injection. So if you don't want, for example, you say, oh great, I have to do a layer 2 network, but wait a minute, layer 2 networks require broadcast for ARP or multicast for IPv6 NDP, but I actually don't want to try and mimic ARP and NDP traffic and actually set up multicast groups or figure out some magic way of making multicast happen on my network. Then you can go through and kind of, if you have that information, there are primitives for just basically injecting those responses, so you don't have to worry about how do I actually go and broadcast this and have someone reply. If you already know the answer, which is more common in a controlled environment or, you know, more of an orchestrated environment, then you can just kind of go through with that. You can also use it as a means for dropping packets or kind of enforcing, there's a lot of things you could do to enforce policy or do a lot more kind of special kind of fancy things there. So the backends themselves that we kind of talked about, they basically implement a simple ops vector dealing with, you know, starting, stopping it, setting properties, doing lookups, things like that. They define the lookup mode. So there we were talking about earlier about, you know, you have a static point-to-point plugin, or you could have, you know, a more dynamic one. So they had to define that. They also had to define a destination type, what they support. So, for example, we talked about NVGRE. All that, because that's at GRE, it just uses an IP address to find the host in question. It doesn't have a port associated with it or anything like that. UDP obviously needs an IP address and a port associated with it, so you can actually find out, you know, figure out where you're going. Yeah?
VARPD is running in global zone.
VARPD will run in any zone that is running an overlay device.
I see.
So
it's like IP, right?
Put differently.
The common way
that say we might deploy this is that we'll have VARPD running in the global zone, we'll create all of our overlay devices in the global zone,
okay.
And then a user will then, you know, get VNICs assigned to their zone, which are created over a specific overlay device.
Right. Okay.
However, there's nothing that stops someone from going and creating their own overlay device in their local zone, and creating additional VNICs on top of that, aside from general privileges and, you know, the fact that it isn't implemented yet. Yeah.
As the result of lookup, does it support like multiple destinations coming back to clone the packet?
It does not at this time. That's just not something that we've kind of gone through and done. Probably because that's not something we've opted at kind of in our current phase to not support multicast and broadcast, and just what we're trying to do with this at Joint, which mimics a lot of what the Googles and EC2s and Amazons are doing. Probably because there's a lot of complicated stuff to do there. That doesn't mean it's not impossible, but I think
that'd be useful for multi-homing. Right. That would be useful for multi-homing, not just multi-pathing, multicast.
Yeah, I think you'd want to kind of tease apart how you want to do that, because that means you're going to have to go, if you're going to say, hey, I need to go rewrite this header a lot of times.
Or does that mean you enter two disks into your kernel, and
then the kernel has to go
to pick one?
Oh, I think there's a lot of ways you want to kind of tease apart what you want to do there. So, since you're interested in me, we can also, I'm not going anywhere. So, obviously these backends can define their own properties. So, as an example, for the point-to-point plugin, you have to define, hey, where am I going? Yeah, tell me. I can't read your mind. And so for our approach, I have two backends. One of these is the direct kind of point-to-point. The other is the files backend, which really is just at this moment a glorified Etsy Ethers. If for those of you who've ever used that to deal with Mac mappings. And with that, we'll demo.
Nice.
So, you know, this is kind of experimental code, but that's kind of real fun. So we have this hosts.json file. This is basically the file format I was just using for the files format. So you have as keys your MAC address. I use kind of arbitrary MAC addresses. Then we have a bunch of different entries here. They're basically just things I was using to experiment with. The only thing you really require are the IP, which is saying where on the network is the host that has this MAC address, and the port, which is saying what port to use. You know, if you're using, say, something like VXLAN where you need a port. Then ARP is basically saying, hey, if someone asks me for ARP, if someone's asking for this IP address, what is the answer? Basically, inverse in terms of how it's defined there. That's the point. The same is true with NDP. So NDP is the IPv6 version of basically ARP, a bit different. And then really just for fun, there's also a DHCP proxy, which is just saying, unlike a traditional DHCP relay, when I see the very first DHCP broadcast, where should I actually unicast it to instead? Do you have a...
And IP can be IPv6, is that IPv4 there?
Yeah, it can be IPv6, yeah. Yeah, they all just use kind of standard V6 sockets and send out either way. So with that, we're going to go just set up a quick network here. So we're going to create overlay. The minus V is specifying what is the overlay ID. So in this case, 23, it's kind of like the specifying the VLAN ID. Then we need to set the encapsulation module, which is VXLAN. we need to set the search plugin, which in this case is the files backend. We're then setting two properties. The first is the VXLAN listen IP, which on this host should be 10.88.88.69. And then we also have to specify and then we give it a name. And then we can deal with the show overlay and see that it exists. You know, we have kind of the DLADM style. You know, you have your current value, what the defaults are, if any, what's possible. So from there, we're going to go ahead and now that we have this, we can create our VNIC. We need to actually make sure we use the MAC address we said existed here. Otherwise, we're going to be very sad. And you know, if you do zero. Okay, if we did this right, we should now be able to pay 10.52, and we can. So to prove that I'm not just making this up and actually just doing a quick pass through, let's actually go through and take a look at what's going on here with Snoop. So we are going to Snoop on V1000V0, that's the physical NIC here. We're going to do UDP and port 4789, because that's the port that's assigned to this. And now let's just quickly leave it happy, and let's pay it, and let's see what we see. There we go. And let's quickly just, so you see that we actually knew it was VXLAN, which is nice. We don't want to resolve the name, so let's just S.
If you turn on minus V, will it go down?
I will show you that, Dan. So we have, these are two going, we see what's going there. So if we go, let's start off with cat V. Or if you know that doesn't get too mangled, then you see that going across. And if you want to get your full, you haven't had enough output yet. That would explain why we didn't see it here.
Thank you, Snoop.
There you go. So now, and then just to prove that, you know, I didn't quite lie about IPv6.
Quite.
What did I choose
here? I should have done.
You don't have any.
Oh, okay.
Doesn't it?
How VXLAN are you getting assigned?
I chose it.
It was part of the DLM.
Oh, I added the DLADM minus V, 23. So I picked 23. So we have some.
There was much rejoicing.
It's your fear.
Oh, that long delay. I didn't say it. So it's taking a bit longer than I thought. Bar 0, I net 6, 1, up, and let's go ahead and tell this to FE 4. And now we gain FE 3, and there we go. So there we go, that's the brief demo, so let's get back to.
Are these on the same physical host?
These are three different VMs on one MacBook, yes.
Okay. So the VXLAN stuff is not actually going out over but it was going out over 1000G.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, it's being switched in the MacBook host.
Yeah.
So each.
Oh, there are three different VMs.
I have three. Yeah. I have three VMs right here.
I see.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah.
No, there's three zones on one.
If we had three zones on the same host with the same virtual network ID, then it would never have left the kernel.
Right.
Because it's smart enough to say, hey, we're on the same we're on the same overlay device. I'm not going to end-cap, decap, send you on the wire, come back, end-cap, decap you.
Right. So yeah. It would never have been encapsulated.
So that's an interesting point. So the overlay device has a degenerate mode that looks like, if I'm understanding you correctly, that looks like EtherStack.
Yes, that's exactly it. On the same host, there's no need to.
Yeah, it makes perfect sense.
It's a feature.
I wanted to underscore the point.
Like a bash feature.
There's some things that have come along the ride so far in this game. I'm sure there'll be a bunch more, so I'm just going to quickly rattle them off. So the first thing is VNIX MTU modification, which is already up in the Lumos. Previously, your VNIX MTU was fixed to be at the size of your physical NIC. This can be problematic. If you say enable jumbo frames on your physical NIC, and then you wanted to use something like this, your VNIC would think it had a 9000 MTU jumbo frame, you would write 9000 bytes, you would then add a VXLAN header, a UDP header, another IP header, another MAC header, and you would be at something like, 9060 bytes. And obviously, network equipment doesn't like that.
So out of curiosity, how does the whole MTU discovery part work if your UDP packets are always going to be inconveniently sized a little larger than your framing size?
So there is no MTU discovery at this time. There's a MTU property which will do something.
And you just have to
set that for your network. Part of the idea here is that because generally you're not going to be, this is designed to be much more in a single data center as opposed to bridging data centers. And so if you want to bridge data centers, you want to probably use a VPN and something.
So what happens though if, let's say a well-designed network sends you an ICMP needs write rotation for V4 back. It goes through the outermost layer of UDP and will deliver it to its endpoint. So your endpoint just drops that right now?
I haven't really experimented too much with it. I've just been using a 1400 byte MTU on the VNIX while I've been
IP tunnels. Doing this. IP and IP tunnels will try. Doesn't always succeed, but they will try and lower the tunnel MTU as appropriate.
Yeah, I mean, we can kind of play around with that. I mean, you've got to figure out what's going to be the principle of least surprise here, because unfortunately the problem is that when you have, say, 100 different destinations all on the network, if one all of a sudden goes to a, 100 byte MTU, you'd logically have to shrink the VNIX MTU down to something small.
Yeah.
But if you do that, then all of a sudden everything else gets worse. So I think we're going to have to kind of play around and figure out what makes sense as an administrative model here, because it's unfortunately,
most
the
people don't do
path
MTU discovery right is the problem.
That's another challenge. So other things that are here, obviously there's the VXLAN encoding in Snoop. You've already seen that. Hopefully we can just add that also as a filter as well. I ported the ID space series of functions that we have in the kernel, which is basically just a simple way of keeping track of identifiers so you don't have to do all the logic of, hey, what's the next free number for this? And that's basically just a library that is built on top of LibUMEM, and that just uses the same code that we use in the kernel, but in userland. I've also implemented a lib rename to get out of the infamous dance of you're renaming a file to a new name, you need to do fsync the files, you need to fsync the directories, you have to fsync it again after rename, there's a long dance there. Just do it once correctly. I've implemented the, there's the ether, the Ethernet to string functions that exist. I've implemented re-entry versions of those just so you don't have to worry about the perthread version in a library. This uses the ksockets under the hood. So ksockets are just the kernel having a socket. One of the things I did there is that basically there's now notion that a ksocket can have a direct callback. So rather than the ksocket having to do, basically having your data go into a kernel buffer there, you then basically will go and you can basically just specify a function to call and still deal with flow control, but it's not buffering in the kernel and waiting for the notice where to call read. It gets basically, as data comes in, it gets passed directly to the to your upstream socket. The other thing I fixed was the send m block support in UDP. We had a slightly broken check that was trying to stop send file from using UDP that was stopping the kernel entry point from working at all, which was kind of unfortunate. The other last thing is that for the hash table here, there was the NPT status ref hash that exists, and I just made that more generic and probably be enhancing that a little bit to do more growing and shrinking, so we get something a little bit better than our current friends in mod hash. Future stuff that's coming along, there's obviously deal manager D, normally is in charge of persisting everything, doesn't do anything related to persistence at all today, but we'll need to. That way, you know, as you reboot your systems, your overlay devices come back the same way everything else does. There's going to be a lot of performance work. You know, we're focusing right now on prototypes and just getting this stuff to work. That's obviously not going to last. You know, obviously for it to go into production, we need to be able to drive pretty close to line rate with minimal overhead, and you know, and figure out what's necessary to do that. we're going to have to do some work on just terms of figuring out how we do resizing the kernel target hash table. So this is basically, some folks are gonna have a lot larger number of targets that they talk to than others. We just wanna be able to kind of intelligently size that and also kind of potentially tie that into the K-Men reaping aspect so that way the zone is too far over its memory cap and this is contributing to it. You can potentially cut this back a little bit. We're gonna also have to be careful with how we do that so it's not just a series of growing, shrinking, and you know, never stopping that. Then the last thing I'll say, the next two things are, see, we're at Joint, we're experimenting with, you know, plugging this into just other distributed systems that we have as part of our software's SDC stack, and you know, that's helping us to inform what these APIs should be, what else might be useful to have in terms of user land for Varpy. Basically, as we build our own system with this and play around with it, what actually makes sense to do. Then also, we obviously have to do a lot better with observability. We want to be able to, you know, obviously having a lot of good stuff here for dtrace, being able to snoop the overlay device itself so you can see what's going on at that layer, being able to dump the target table, kind of like you can the routing table for a zone, things like that. So
yeah. This, the distributed stuff, that's all for Varp, right?
It's all user land. So, yeah, kernel.
When you're doing your async up call into that, you're just dropping packets until the
Yeah, basically you're going to set a threshold for how much outstanding data you want to have.
Okay.
And
It's actually just like ARP.
It's kind of the thing. Like the kernel can't keep packets around for ARP forever, so eventually we do have to drop that stuff. So it's the same principle.
So keeping data around, you're doing that per destination, right?
Yes, it's chained per destination, but the cap is probably going to be on a per device basis.
Sure.
That's it. So you can take this home today. So the code is in a branch of a Lumos Joint. That's where I'm doing all my development. There's a current development I put out another development snapshot, which is basically just some SmartOS images that already have this code in there, which this is what I was using to demo it. It's all prototype code. There's almost certainly a panic or a lot more sitting there. It's almost certainly should not be used in production. I tell that to people and they still sometimes go do that, so I'm just trying to say that again, like, this stuff really, really should be in some production. That's it. And then thank a couple folks. So Dan and Sebastian Roy, who's not here, and Joel, who has dealt with a series of my pestering and somewhat annoying questions of a lot of this stuff. I want to thank the bunch of folks at Joint who have helped, you know, us kind of think through this, refine this, slog through very long design documents and help with this. OmniTI for helping put together Lumos Day, and just the Lumos community in general for all their support. So that's it. Any questions?
You done much compatibility tests with physical machines running OpenBSD or?
Yeah, I have. So yeah, I tested our. That's the first thing I did with our VXLAN implementation and made sure it worked with OpenBSD
stuff. Hardware implementations.
I don't have any hardware implementation sitting around, so I use the other software implementation I know about on a different physical machine.
Okay, so you guys run top of rack VXLAN switches now?
No, the whole point of this work is to actually have from Joint's perspective, is to actually not have to have any switch upgrades or magic hardware to run this. And then you can basically just use standard layer 3 IP switches.
All right.
But I have tested with other VXLAN implementations to make sure they could actually receive our packets, they could send to us, we decode them. And also double checked it with Wireshark to make sure it saw what we thought was valid. So, I do know that what we're generating is valid and matches. It's
just wondering how hard it would be to take these VXLAN, drop them right on a VXLAN capable switch. So
it doesn't need. Yeah.
I mean, it depends a lot on your switch. All it's going to need to kind of. So I think you're going to want to figure out with your switch how the switch does it, what that looks like. For some, it may just be as simple as same way you have a VLAN tag. You have a VXLAN tag that you just stick in the port. For others, it may be something much more complicated where it's aware of the routing fabric. So, it's one of those things where I think you have a lot of vendors doing a lot of different things in this space, and you're going to figure out what that is with that. Obviously, I'm happy to talk to anyone in the community who's also working with vendors about this stuff and making sure we use stuff that can be helpful and leverage. And I definitely have gone around to other Illumos vendors, folks who are in this space, to kind of talk with them about to make sure. They understood what was going on and see what input they had. So far everyone's been fairly supportive of it. Other questions? Yeah.
Have you done any performance tests?
Nope, I've done no performance testing because it's just running in my VMware VMs. Because it's still prototype code, I want to get the functionality working and then I'll worry about performance. Because once I have something that actually works functionally, I'll have a sense of where to go optimize my time with performance. And I just haven't spent the time, honestly, because I don't know what's going to change yet. And I don't want to go spend a bunch of time getting the data path super, super fast and super, super hot and clean when it then goes and changes because of something else I didn't realize. So.
Okay.
That answer?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, but don't worry. Performance work will be done, and we'll make sure that this stuff stays. Because if it doesn't, our customers will be all of us.
Scaling would be for in terms of traffic volumes that you would be aiming to get?
The goal is basically you should be able to, realistically, so first off, you have to be driving, the question is today, can your application drive line rate? True or false? If that's true, then we have to kind of start thinking about it. And the question is, what are the latency constraints? Obviously, we want to minimize latency, we want to maximize any hit in packets per second in throughput. But on the flip side, there's also there's also stuff that happens, it's not free. So, we're just gonna have to see where we go and then try and make it as acceptable as possible. There's no pre-notion of a target because what the target is different for so many different environments.
Okay.
So you may not be able to answer this, but your target deployment scale of this, say 5 years from now, are you looking at 100,000 physical machines, 10 million VMs sort of thing,
right.
Or is that those the right numbers, a million physical machines?
Yeah, we actually got through and thought through the logical, how large would it, so say you had a single VM that talked to a million different machines.
Okay.
Right, which is a lot. Yeah. It's actually really a lot for a single machine to have.
We have that now.
You have a single machine that has 1,000 MAC addresses it talks to?
No, MAC.
But if you work on that,
sure.
And then you then say, okay, what's the size of the target cache? Okay, let's say we have 16 bytes, 32, or sorry, IPv6 addresses, 16 bytes. Let's say you have 64 bytes of information per each of these.
Right.
So that's 64 megs for one of these devices of kernel memory, where you have to have a pretty large DRAM footprint kernel, a pretty beefy machine to be driving that much.
Sure,
So
that's the target scale.
We'd like to, obviously, there's going to be a lot of testing involved in terms of getting to scale. We obviously use this in our own data centers and talking to lots of machines and deal with lots of VMs, but obviously,
The target scale is essentially arbitrary scale. That if you run the numbers, the limiting factor is the number of VMs that a given VM is going to talk to, and that number, not the number of physical machines. So if you are, and you just kind of do the math, and it's not a, so
look, it's the number of VMs, number of MAC addresses,
in a
total
given,
number of VMs on a given host pocket.
On a given VXLAN.
On a given.
Well, so I think the key is to take apart which parts of scalability we're worried about. So I mean, for a given device, it's how many, what's the size of its target cache, is that fast, are our lookups fast, and how do we deal with that? Obviously, there's going to be a lot of scaling timing with there. You know, if you have, okay, that's not me. Okay. If you have, hey, I would put 1,000 machines on this, and that's going to take us to scalability in a different, you know, a single host, that's going to take us to scalability in a different direction. And you know, obviously, for all these things, we're just going to have to kind of even, see where it goes.
Here's another way to phrase it: you're talking about number of machines across a broad data center and the number of VMs in that data center. It's the wrong way to think about it. The right way to think about it is the number of VMs that you're going to run on a single physical machine and how many VMs each of those VMs is going to talk to.
Correct.
And that's actually, those are the only factors that actually matter from a from a scalability perspective.
Just well, for the kernel scale, obviously there's a lot of questions from in terms of how you design your network and everyone else. Right?
The network topology discovery.
Not only minimizes some of the problems, but those are the actual scalability factors that matter for this work.
For this.
And the if you think about it, like 1,000 VMs running on a single machine is a lot. And probably will be a lot even in 5 years.
Yeah.
And if each of those 1,000 machines is talking to 1,000 other VMs, that's also a lot and will probably also be a lot in 5 years. And that's a million things. And that's not a lot. A million things, a million entities that you're keeping track of in a cache is not a lot when you have at now a quarter of a terabyte of DRAM. The numbers just end up being not
because these
large.
Are small entries, too. So far,
like, discussion is more like lacking microcropping and so on, but like, this end world is now about like route by any flag by like offsetting your packet or something like that, by protocol, by UDP one way, the other way, and so on. Is there like lookups for that sort of stuff in those like?
Yeah, so I mean, obviously, to be able to, when you're pulling this down, obviously, to implement proxy ARP, you need to be able to read the entire ARP packet. So, yes, while you can get the entire packet as part of making that decision for a given MAC address, obviously, if you're going to want to do that in userland for every packet, you know, for every MAC address, you're also going to have to kind of look at it, but.
More like
to the
given offset, like to look that far in the header or something.
Yeah, you can pull down the entire header in userland to make your decisions.
So you could potentially
change
and send different basically contentified networking. So you could change ISCSI to go over a network that makes people regret their decisions.
you could drop all ISCSI.
You could. Today is only. Yeah, I mean, I think
the secure ISCSI.
The trick again with all this is going to be, you know, how does that interplay with the kernel hash table? Because the kernel is really caching right now on the MAC address granularity. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we can do some work to change where that destination is. So,
but you're already tied to it at VXLAN and an overlay network. I'm actually thinking of a layer above that, so when the packet comes in, it would actually get bound into a different
VXLAN.
Different VXLAN. Bad VXLAN.
You
could do that. It's a little above this, right?
You kind of want to have something different in front of your. You kind of almost want something in front, like you put that on top, your VXLAN on top of that.
Right, exactly.
And, but we can kind of. As this exists, we can kind of, that's a great thing. It should be pretty easy to straight go forward and explore it.
So the key to this work is it makes VXLANs relatively cheap and pretty highly programmable. So that kind of stuff actually does become pretty straightforward.
Yeah. Other questions?
Will the VXLAN implementation with the usage of Elevo, TSO, and the other
offloading? So the question was, what happens to LSO, TSO, other offload capabilities as you use VXLAN? So that basically comes down to your NIC vendor. By default, so say you just kind of take the standard, say Intel 1 gig NIC that you're using today or Intel 10 gig NIC, yes, it does break the use of LSO, TSO. And then that's just kind of how it was defined. There's, you know, other times they're trying to more plug in there. The other thing we're seeing is that NICs are now adding now hardware checksum support. So basically, the newest Intel 40 gig cards can basically say, okay, are you, like, instead of just saying do a normal IP checksum, you can say actually do a VXLAN checksum. So I can basically take all that into account and basically do both checksums. What will, how that will evolve with TSO and LSO is an interesting question, because unfortunately the way those work for TCP doesn't work as well with, you would basically have to do the, you'd have to do that before you endcap. And then you still have to kind of figure out exactly what that looks like. You can't basically, you have to, when you send the endcap packet out of the wire, it has to be large already. But that's also where you may see future encapsulations coming around that deal with that. So.
Yeah, today, Intel 10 gig hardware will help you if you know how to program the card for IPsec. It will do your checksum, TCP UDP checksum, and then it goes and encrypts the damn thing. So it can be done. It just needs to be done for VXLAN and whatever.
But the card's going to have the VXLAN installation support to do it.
Yeah, you're going to need an evolved card, but it is possible.
I would also say that's kind of where things are going. VXLAN is winning. So I think you can expect more hardware support for VXLAN.
You already did see hardware support show up in the current generation of cards. So there's going to check something first, and then there'll be other stuff next, presumably, or that stuff will evolve. So.
That's a tiny question.
Yep.
It's performance related, but it's something you can measure in the VM case. How much of a latency hit are you getting on that first packet? Relative to the line lanes.
Haven't really looked.
Okay, it's just.
I mean, not enough to know.
Notice it
at this time, but also if you're using a files-based format, it's already sitting in NVList in memory, as opposed to say having to do a ARP-style lookup or ARP-style query or however you do it to some centralized data.
Some people notice their TCP SYN timings get all screwed up with any sort of external resolver. So that's why I'm asking. It's something somebody will complain to you about at some point.
Probably. However, the other thing that we have here is that because you're going to have to do some kind of either NTP or ARP query for that MAC address, you're going to...
That may take a hit for you.
That will most likely pull down information for you. Or, the way, depending on how you actually do the measurements, in terms of how you actually design your piece of userland, you may just say, hey, userland has an entire copy of the database, so it just answers it like that, and you deal with cap trade-offs some other way, but there you start getting into the messiness of how you do the distributed systems.
Yeah. And I'm just saying that TCP SYN packet, some people, and then there's like queuing policies of it. If I retransmit the SYN, do I send the first one out or do I drop that first SYN? Where you have to start being aggressive about which one you reap in some cases.
And there's definitely going to be a lot of analysis and things to go do here and play with and kind of understand failure mode. So.
Cool. Thank you, that was awesome.
Okay. Thanks, everyone.